Okay, why don't we get started here? This is the panel on Western concepts of law and justice. I'm Professor Pushaw. I'm here moderating the panel. We have Eric Enlow from Hamdong University School of Law in Korea. It's a long story how he ended up there that I don't have all the details. Randy Beck from the University of Georgia, Zach Kalo, and David Van Drunen. So we're just going to go in the order that these guys are listed in the program. So we'll start with Eric.
Thank you. So fortunately for me, I'm going to really continue on with what Professor Walterserf was talking about this morning. He cited a line from Justinian's Institutes and from the Digest on the nature of justice. And the famous line that he quoted is, "Justice is the steady and enduring will to give to each his right, or his jus." You can translate it as his law, his right. You can translate it in various ways. He left off the very next line, which really supports his thesis that justice is not a thin and monochromatic value, but that the love that's expressed in justice has multiple forms. And he mentioned some of the important ones: giving each his due, not harming, and as we'll see, Ulpian, who Justinian is quoting here, goes on and says something else. So it begins, justice, steady will to give everyone his due. The second part is, and the precepts of jus, the thing that you're supposed to give to everybody, are three: to live honorably, not to harm another, and to give over to each one what is his. And then he concludes this idea by saying, in jurisprudence, and that's the prudence about right, a practical working knowledge of right, is knowledge of God and man and the understanding of justice and injustice. So it's a nice circle. What is justice? Justice is something about right. What is right? Right has three aspects. It living to God, in Leibniz's understanding, living honorably, not harming, and then giving each what is his. And finally, how do we come to mastery of that? We have to know God, we have to know man, and that returns us to the idea of justice. So I think for most of us, we're not familiar at all, in the thinnest way maybe, with that definition of justice, but we've really missed something in modern times, beginning in the earliest days of the recovery of the Corpus Juris Civilis, which was Justinian's codification of more than 1,500 years of Roman law. There has been a steady stream of commentaries about this notion of justice. Hundreds and hundreds of commentaries, unfortunately blocked from us by the Latin language, but there's an enormous tradition of interpreting it, and I think it would be extremely valuable for us to recover it, in part because it captures what Professor Walterserf was saying, namely this long-standing conviction among Christian jurists that justice is not thin, that the love that we want to show to each other in society cannot be understood monoconceptually, but has these three different elements. We need to understand this in part because Roman jurisprudence has been so very fundamental to Western law. These ideas, at the beginning of the Institutes and at the beginning of the Digests, when people looked for ways of understanding the law, and remember what they're looking at is there's 12 volumes of complicated legal rules, and they want to provide some order, some structure, some taxonomy to these rules. They looked in the very beginning of the Digest and the Institutes for this structure and the precepts of law, to live honorably, not to harm, to give each his due. They thought, well, that's our best contender for a structure for all of these rules about contract, tort, property, personal status. All of these look to be summed up and given structure by these things. The tradition of commentary on these three precepts and the attempt to organize law by these three precepts moves all the way from the 11th century all the way through the 19th century, when for a variety of reasons it becomes disfavored. But we find Kant, we find Leibniz, we find Pufendorf, we find Grotius, in the common law tradition, Bracton, Blackstone, up and through the 19th century, every great jurisprudential figure that you can imagine is wrestling with the three precepts and trying to understand how they can be unfolded as a great exposition of the nature of law and justice. Both at the time they were put forward in the 6th century by Justinian and up through the modern period, everybody also understood that these not only had a long tradition moving from the 11th century, but if you went back in time, you find all of these concepts, all these precepts discussed by Plato, for example, in the third book of the Republic. He lays out and talks about how these three precepts relate together. You find them in Cicero, of course, laid out. You find versions of them in Aristotle, but very differently. Aristotle has a very different schema. Also, the great enemy of this approach is Epicurus, who everyone knew. And Epicurus said, no, everybody else is wrong. Actually, justice is monochromatic, and it means not harming. So if you looked back from the time of Justinian, when he says justice has these three dimensions, he's rejecting an Aristotelian view. He's rejecting very stridently an Epicurean view. This was a matter of great importance. They thought it was very important to proclaim at the outside, at the beginning of law, justice cannot be considered thinly. It must be considered in terms of these three strands. As I mentioned before, there's another dimension of this. If you read through the Digest, you read through the Institutes, they're also filled with a number of other trichotomous divisions of law. So very famously, you find Justinian saying, and I'm saying Justinian, but actually it's the editors, you find Justinian saying, well, law can also be divided, not only according to these three precepts of justice, but you also find in law the jus civile, the jus gentium, and the jus naturale, natural law, the law of the nations, and the law of the state. And so one question they had is, do these three precepts line up in some way with these fundamental three divisions between natural law, state law, and the law of the nation? Other really famous trichotomies in Roman law, all the law, they said, could be divided into issues relating to persons or to things or to actions. And so another question was, well, do these three precepts of justice somehow line up with our different relationship between persons, things, and legal capacities? Lots of other famous threefold divisions I discuss in the paper, but suffice it to say, if you're reading Roman law, you're coming across this notion that the law can be divided according to three great values, of which not harming is an integral one, that you can't conceive of justice without conceiving of not harming, importantly for this conference, but also without conceiving of what it is that we owe to other people and what it means to live an honorable life. Christian jurists, as soon as they got a hold of these materials in the Middle Ages, also started thinking about these in terms of other famous trichotomies in the scriptures. So for example, they asked, what does this have to do with Deuteronomy 6:5, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength? Can we read these three precepts onto that? What about Micah 6:8? You should do justice, you should love kindness, you should walk humbly with God. How does it relate to our belief, the traditional belief first set out in Jerome's prologue to the Book of Kings, that the law could be divided into ceremonial laws, judicial laws, and moral laws? How do these trichotomies that we see, the division of the scriptures into the law and the prophets and the holy writings, how does it relate to these sort of things? The reformers asked, how does it relate to the three usages of law that they laid out? So what you get by the time you get to Justinian, in Roman culture, there's this idea that there are, from the Trinity, threefold patterns in reality, the vestiges of the Trinity it's sometimes referred to, and that this shows up in all sorts of places. So in Ausonius's 4th century poem, it's called The Riddle of Threes, he lays out all the threefold structures in law, all the threefold structures in other aspects of nature. So he says, law is divided into all these different threes, medicine is divided into all these threes, rhetoric is divided into all these three things, and the physicists count three causes, God, matter, and form. Nature follows this, law follows this, and here we have something related to the Trinity. There's a push to locate all of these metaphysical things within the relationship of these three precepts. The precepts, we don't really know what precepts are anymore, but precepts are a part of an art. When you talk about precepts in Roman law, you're talking about it in relationship to an art. And Cicero says, an art is a collection of precepts that shows not just a familiarity with particulars, but an understanding of how things work that affect our practice. They guide our practice. And the goal of a precept is not to say everything the way we did today, writing massive treatises, but to condense everything into an unbelievably small number of precepts, of rules, that can be unfolded in time. And so when the glossators and the civilians got a hold of these precepts, one of the things they did is they said, well, how do you unpack these? And you don't have the text in front of you, but it's interesting. The pronouns are indefinite, and there are no conjunctions among the precepts. And so one of the questions they asked is, well, how are these three things related? Are they related by ands, or are they related by ors? And the Romans had two types of ors. They had, what does an or mean? They had two answers. It either meant one or the other, or it meant it could be two, one of the two. And so they said, well, the precepts actually are asking us a question about the nature of justice. One possibility is that you only have justice when you have honorable living, when you have non-harming, and when you have proper distribution of property. It's like the three tastes of ice cream. It has to be creamy, it has to be cold, and it has to be sweet, or it isn't ice cream. And other people said, no, they're or, and it means they're synonyms for each other. Living honorably means the same thing as not harming. It means the same thing as giving to other people their due. Some people said it means or, but they're arranged metonymically. They're in a hierarchy, so that what you're really saying is to live honorably means, it entails, it necessarily follows that you're not harming. And this had enormous impacts on their jurisprudence, because if you believe that what it means not to harm is to give someone else their due, then you don't have a negative conception of harming. You think that a failure to give is a kind of harm. Another aspect of this is they asked, well, who is it that is giving the due? The natural assumption is that when you say to give to each his due, that it's the recipient who is getting his due. And one of the points they made as good Christians, they said, well, if everybody got their due, as actually Shakespeare picks up on this, if everybody got their due, everybody would be in for a whipping. That's the Shakespearean line. They put it a little bit differently. If everybody got their due, we would all be damned. We would all, even in a civil context, be fit for punishment. So it must be that the due that we're referring to is the jus that comes from God. That justice is to give people God's right, not their right, but God's right. And this is a view that was taken up, particularly Leibniz has a very famous interpretation after centuries and centuries. He's one of the last great contributors to this literature. It dies with Kant for a variety of reasons. But Leibniz makes this view, and he says that the three precepts really all command the same thing, and the question is, whose due are you giving? with the highest due, living honorably, being giving due to God, and the laws of the state referring only to precepts that relate to the dues of man. And I think I'm over, so I'll just conclude by pointing out to you that this whole structure is found for us in a remarkable way in Romans 13. In Romans 13, in the second half, beginning in verse 12, we find Paul enjoining people to love. And he says, you ought to love because love renders to everyone their due. You ought to love because love harms no one. And in the place of living honorably, he says, you ought to love because it's by taking on Christ, it's by wearing Christ, that you have the capacity to fulfill all these other duties. So there's a very interesting parallel in Paul between his understanding of harm and of giving people their due and of loving and this tradition, which I think really needs to be recovered for its richness and its provision of precepts, which really allow us to capture the multivalent aspects of any right concept of justice. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Thank you to Bob and the Nootbaar Institute for the chance to participate in this conference and for the wonderful hospitality. It's nice to be on a panel with people I know and respect. David and I got to work together on a chapter in a book project that Pepperdine sponsored a few years ago on law and the Bible. And then Eric and I met as participants in a conference last September sponsored by Emory Center for the Study of Law and Religion. I'm happy to report that conference did not take place in Atlanta. It was instead in Berlin. And so Eric and I have scored trips to Malibu and Berlin in one academic year. I haven't met Zachary before, but I'm looking forward to hearing him as well. The Emory conference that we participated in September was focused on what Christian theology could offer to the world of law. And my take on that question began with a reflection that we heard yesterday in the morning presentation by Rabbi Dorf, that the biblical authors often portray God as a judge. They describe a final judgment at the end of history, but they also highlight instances in which God acts judicially as he providentially oversees human affairs. This recurring biblical portrayal of God as a judge invites reflection on the relationship between divine justice and human justice. How are they alike and how are they different? And so I thought it could be useful to pursue that same inquiry at this conference as we think about how to do justice without doing harm. It seems to me that some of the ways that human justice might produce harm flows from the differences between God as judge and the human judges who implement human law. So I want to start with the story of the rich man and Lazarus that Jesus tells in Luke's gospel. The narrative concerns a rich man who feasts daily. He routinely walks past a poor beggar named Lazarus, but he never stops to help. Jesus artistically describes how the rich man and Lazarus effectively trade places in the afterlife. Several parallels are highlighted in the chart here, but in his earthly life, the rich man lived in luxury. But in the afterlife, it's Lazarus who rests in the bosom of Abraham. Lazarus was hungry and covered with sores, but now the rich man is thirsty and tormented by flame. Lazarus longed for something very small, crumbs from the rich man's table. In the afterlife, it's the rich man that longs for something very small, drops of water from Lazarus' finger. Lazarus begged, but the rich man never stopped to help. In the afterlife, the rich man begs, but Lazarus cannot help. In this life, the rich man was presumably well known, while Lazarus was a nameless beggar. In the afterlife, Lazarus has a name, and it's the rich man who remains anonymous. Jesus' story, I think, is a picture of perfect retributive justice. The sufferings of Lazarus in this life are matched by the rich man's sufferings after death. The rich man's indifference is matched by Lazarus' incapacitation. Jesus' story, I think, is effectively an extended illustration of one of the Proverbs, Proverbs 21:13, whoever closes his ear to the cry of the poor will himself call out and not be answered. Second example comes from the book chapter that David and I worked on. In Genesis 27, there's the famous story of Jacob stealing the blessing that his father Isaac intended to bestow on Jacob's brother Esau. The events are all orchestrated by Jacob's mother Rebekah. While Esau is out hunting, Jacob brings savory food to his father. He dresses like Esau. He takes advantage of the fact that Isaac is blind and cannot see. And this deception allows Jacob to substitute the younger son for the older son. It deprives Isaac of a significant choice, the ability to choose who will be his spiritual heir. A couple of chapters later, Jacob suffers a deception comparable to the one that he inflicted on Isaac. This time, the events are orchestrated by Rebekah's brother, Laban. Jacob has worked 7 years for the right to marry Laban's younger daughter, Rachel. When the time has passed, Laban prepares a wedding feast, reminiscent of the savory food that Jacob brought to Isaac. Laban then takes advantage of the fact that it's nighttime and that Jacob cannot see. He substitutes the older daughter, Leah, for the younger daughter, Rachel. Presumably, the deception is aided by the fact that Leah is dressed in a bridal veil so that Jacob can't tell the difference between her and her sister. Just as Isaac was deprived of the choice of who would inherit his blessing, Jacob is deprived of the choice of who will be his wife. I think the author of Genesis wants us to see divine justice at work, providentially treating Jacob the way he treated his father. Third example from 2 Chronicles concerns King Uzziah. The author of Chronicles tells us how the king entered the temple to burn incense, even though the law of Moses reserved that function for the priests descended from Aaron. By locating the kingship within the tribe of Judah and the priesthood within the tribe of Levi, God had instituted a form of separation of powers, effectively separation of temple and state. Uzziah's attempt to usurp the priestly function ends when God strikes him with leprosy on the forehead. The punishment of Uzziah isn't really explained in the text, but I think if we think carefully about the details, we can see its retributive character. First, Uzziah violated God's rules governing God's house, and now Uzziah can't govern even in his own house, a task that falls to his son. Uzziah tried to seize religious authority that God didn't give him, and so he effectively loses the political authority that God did give him. And one of the interesting details is that God strikes Uzziah with leprosy on his forehead. Why would that be? I think it's an allusion to the law of Moses. The high priest was supposed to wear a gold plate on his forehead that said, "Holy to the Lord." By giving Uzziah leprosy, a sign of uncleanness on his forehead, I think God is essentially exposing the false claim of moral worthiness that underlay Uzziah's actions. Finally, my fourth example focuses on divine rewards rather than punishments. In chapter 4 of Matthew's gospel, the devil takes Jesus to a high mountain. It's the third of the three temptations, shows him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory, and he offers to give all those kingdoms to Jesus, if Jesus will bow down and worship him. Jesus refuses the temptation based on the Deuteronomic principle that worship has to be reserved for God alone. I think Matthew intends for us to hear an echo of that passage near the end of the gospel. Once again, Jesus is on a mountain. Now the disciples are worshiping him, which I think is one of Matthew's clues to Jesus' divine identity. Jesus tells the disciples that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. The point, I think, is that Jesus refused the devil's temptation to take an easy route to the kingship, and the result is that he's rewarded with an authority that is like, but even greater than, the authority that Satan had offered him. So, in light of the theme of the conference, I thought focusing on examples of divine justice might help us think through some of the reasons human law might do harm. The answer, I think, may lie in differences between God the judge and the humans who create and implement human law. I've listed three illustrative differences here, but there are others we might include as well. First, God is omniscient, right? He knows all things. He can read the thoughts of the heart. Humans aren't omniscient. Human judges have to apply law to facts that they didn't observe. So judges and juries try to reconstruct prior events, but they always have to do that based upon spotty and incomplete evidence. As a result, human legal systems often make mistakes. Every year, we find people who have been convicted of a crime and then become convinced that they didn't really commit the crime, or at least that we don't have adequate evidence to believe that they did. And this happens even when we're applying a very high burden of proof, beyond a reasonable doubt. Imagine how much more often the human legal system must commit errors when it's a lower standard of proof, like preponderance of the evidence. I suspect, presumably, every year there will be hundreds of people forced to pay tort judgments, even though they were being as careful as you reasonably could expect them to be. Every year there will be people punished for discrimination in employment who acted with pure intentions, and there will be people who are not held responsible, even though they were secretly engaging in rank discrimination. And we could list lots of other examples where the human legal system, because of the nature of the judges and their differences from the divine judge, just simply get the facts wrong and impose judgment based upon facts that never happened. Second, humans don't possess God's power and resources. As a result, they have to enforce a narrower range of obligations than God as judge has the power to enforce. William Stuntz one time in an article put it this way. He says that you're never going to find a human law requiring each person to forgive his brother 70 times 7. Right? That means that human justice is never fully and properly going to adjudicate the relationship, the dispute that arises between two parties. At best, it will offer a partial attempt at an incomplete justice. And it's not unlikely that some of those human judgments will result in a wrong outcome if one took into account all of the demands of justice imposed by the law of God. Every year, the law will allow landlords to evict tenants, or creditors will be allowed to collect debts, even when, in God's eyes, perhaps the landlord should let the tenant stay or the creditor should forgive the debt. Every year, the law will allow wrongdoing spouses to abandon innocent spouses with minimal consequences, and we could go through lots of other ways in which the human law enforces a much narrower range of obligations than the law of God. Third, human lawgivers and judges don't possess God's integrity. As a result, our laws often aim at goals other than real justice or even the common good. I recently read Brian Tominaha's book, Law as a Means to an End. He offers a very compelling account of the ways in which many participants in our legal order have given up on a notion of the common good. Instead, law becomes this tool that you try to press to advance the interests of particular groups rather than any common good. So these three differences between God the judge and actors in a human legal system illustrate reasons why I think our justice sometimes does harm, even when we're trying to do justice. I suspect there are lots of others we could list, and so in our question and answer time, I'd be happy to hear your thoughts as well.
Well, good afternoon. It's good as always to be back at Pepperdine. Now that I live in the Middle East, the climatological necessity of coming here is somewhat diminished, but it's greater in every other respect. What I want to talk about this afternoon is the approach to justice in modern Catholic social thought. And the way I want to approach this is from the perspective that attempts to identify overarching patterns concerning how Catholic social thought over the long sweep of decades has not only cultivated an account of justice, but has developed an accompanying account of how to engage politics in order to realize this justice. I hope, though, that this will not only be a Catholic story, but one that presents some important questions for contemporary Christian legal and political thought more generally. The central claim that I want to offer is that the church has attempted to realize justice by binding modernity within a moral and religious framework. That is, the church has not placed itself in opposition to political modernity, but has rather sought to critically and constructively envision a modernity made anew. It has attempted to envision an authentic modernity, a healthy modernity, that preserves the categories and insights of modern politics while restructuring its foundations, its meaning, and its ends. At base, then, the church has been engaged in a project of renewal or recovery, appropriating the concepts, the language, the institutions of the modern age, while fundamentally re-narrating them in light of a determined and stable form of moral order. You can see this broad methodology, if you will, playing out in different areas of engagement. So let me briefly and with disturbingly cursorily describe what I have in mind by reference to a few different areas that have been of some foundational importance to Catholic social thought. Human rights, for instance. The church has embraced quite vigorously the language of rights, but in turn has grounded those rights in what John Paul called the, quote, moral logic which is built into human life. This logic in turn has led the church to talk about human rights as facilitating development of what it is called an authentic humanism or an integral humanism. Religious freedom, as another example. The church has, again, quite vigorously embraced the normativity of religious freedom. But it has proposed that such freedom must be understood within a theological framework that links it to the facilitation of the final end of the human person, which is participation in the truth of God's self. Freedom is most basically then a freedom to, or even a freedom towards, rather than a freedom from. Economic justice, another area, similarly, I think, reveals this broad approach or methodology. Although perhaps the context here is somewhat more complex. In brief, I would propose that what took shape over the 20th century, particularly in the papal tradition, was the acceptance of the modern market economy as a vehicle for creativity and justice, but paired with a stinging critique of its dehumanizing tendencies. Catholic social thought thus came to advance what one American commentator described as true economic liberalism. I think it's possible, though, just as a caveat, to propose that perhaps this project reached its high point with the thought of John Paul and has, in complicated ways, been unwound both by Pope Benedict and Pope Francis. Let me finally mention the concept of the secular, which I think reveals with particular profundity the Church's attempt to constructively reformulate the modern inheritance. I would here point to Pope Benedict's interesting work on the idea of what he calls healthy secularity or authentic secularity, which he defines most basically as an account of the secular that, quote, includes God. Thus, against a secularism that he describes as excluding Christian contents from public life, Benedict aims to articulate a different understanding of what secular politics entails. So again, this is all very, very cursory, but I think you can begin to see that across these foundational aspects of Catholic engagement, you see a similar methodology being employed. The language, the categories, the concepts, indeed the insights of what has defined much of the architecture of what we think of as the moral discourse of political modernity, the church has seized, but then re-envisioned in light of a theological economy how those concepts are to be understood. Let me emphasize just a few kind of summary points that try to tie together the methodology I'm describing. First, it seems to me that what emerged out of this tradition was not a theory of justice, or even a formula for determining justness. Rather, Catholic social thought, at least as we think about it in terms of the question of justice, is best understood as proposing a disposition for envisaging the terms of justice within present realities. Secondly, this emergent account of justice has been grounded primarily in an account of the human person, in a theological anthropology. And the central concern of this tradition has been to consider what facilitates authentic human flourishing. This consideration runs through the approach to human rights, to economic justice, to human rights, and indeed to the account of the secular, which in interesting ways is itself something of an anthropological doctrine. And this account of the human person, I should add, has been developed with respect both to the insights of reason as well as with respect to the insights of theology. You can think of Benedict's famous Regensburg address where he critiques modern politics and especially modern law for being fundamentally unreasonable. but equally in other contexts you see a much more determined theological critique that views modernity as fundamentally incompatible with certain forms of Christian understanding. And thirdly, as a kind of summary point, I would propose that what emerges ultimately out of this tradition, at least in a broad sweep, has been an account of justice that is both Catholic in a very distinctive and determined way, but also fundamentally liberal. That in many ways, the theme that runs through the Catholic tradition has been an attempt to cultivate a Catholic liberalism. And that to think about or to understand how the tradition has understood justice, we must begin by thinking about this overarching idea of a Catholic entering into forms of political liberalism. And these twin dynamics, the Catholic and the liberal, form the distinctive vision of what we might call a Catholic modernity. This Catholic modernity was not an attempt to return to an idealized Christian past, nor was it an unqualified embrace of a world made anew. It was rather, at least as I would read it, an effort to harvest from modernity key insights done over time by critically embracing key categories and concepts, human rights, religious freedom, economic freedom, the secular, while aiming to reconnect their meaning to an overarching moral order grounded in reason and Christian proclamation. Catholic social thought found in these ideas, as I've described them, the basic imprint of Christian insight, finding in the way that these, finding within the notion of religious freedom, in the idea of the secular, in the idea of a market economy, certain fragments of insight into human nature that could not be but grounded in Christianity, but which had in various ways been divorced from the fullness of that understanding. And thus the project of Catholic thought was to refuse those connections. So this tradition rested above all on the idea that modernity could be reformed and that justice could be realized by going through rather than against or around the basic political and economic institutions of the age. There has been an overriding sanguinity that defines the church's work, resting on a belief that sufficient cultural capital remains to recover from the assets of modernity genuine Christian insights. Indeed, there has been, I think, a belief that modernity, in fact, helps disclose what Charles Taylor has called authentic developments of the gospel. That is, there's a dialogical relationship between Christianity and modernity, a kind of mutual transformative critique, such that Christianity not simply stands in critical posture towards the age, but in fact learns things that were pregnant always within the gospel, but it required something from the outside to draw out the full meaning of that gospel. The question, though, with which I want to conclude is whether this project, at least as I've described it, is a viable and desirable approach to Christian thinking about justice. Is there an adequate base of shared moral understanding? Are there sufficient cultural resources for Christianity to participate in advancing justice on these terms? If the answer is no, and I think we at least need to be open to that possibility, then we are confronted with the demand to rethink the terms on which Christianity is to witness to justice in this historical moment. Indeed, it might then be necessary to rethink the language by which Christians talk about and enact justice. We might well be in a moment where the dialogue about justice is deeply destabilized and decentered. In a 2012 address to American bishops, Pope Benedict opened by stating that at the heart of every culture, whether perceived or not, is a consensus about the nature of reality and the moral good, and thus about the conditions for human flourishing. But then Benedict quickly pulled back and went on to observe that, quote, the consensus has eroded significantly. What then, we might ask, is the meaning of justice in a fractured late modernity where there is deep division about basic moral goods, about the nature of freedom, about the terms of human flourishing, indeed about the very nature of the human person himself or herself? Catholic social thought took shape within a cultural context that contained the residues of Christian cultural capital. And political liberalism, I would propose, in the setting offered a receptacle, an attractive and appealing receptacle, for the realization of the church's social witness. Yet it might be, that the trajectory of modernity has outstripped the capacity of the church to bind it within an overarching social vision. And maybe some of the developments we've talked about over the course of this weekend help to disclose with greater clarity what maybe has been present for a while but not fully recognized. And if that's the case, then it will be necessary for Catholic social thought and indeed Christian approaches to justice premised on the realization of the moral potentialities of a secular age to be reappraised. Remy Brog ends his quite magnificent book, The Law of God, by stating that, and let me just quote a long sentence here. There is nothing to prove that the Western conception of the political is secure, or even viable in the long run. Whether human action can unfold freely with no reference to the divine, rather than losing its way in suicidal dialectics, remains to be seen. Of course, it might well be that it is important to not only ask Brog's question about whether a social order that gives no reference to God can survive, but we also might ask even more basically whether such an order can be just. In Book 19 of The City of God, Augustine famously argued that when justice is properly understood, the answer to that question must be no. And if the social order of modernity has, like the Roman Commonwealth of Augustine's time, reached such a point, then the task of Christian justice might be quite different than we have commonly understood it to be. Thank you.
Always good to be back at Pepperdine, and grateful also for opportunity to participate. Let me begin by somewhat apologizing for the boring and not very helpful title of the program. You could say that my brief paper is about the relationship of natural law and human law, but in probably an unexpected way. A very old conviction in Christian theology, ethics, and jurisprudence, spanning many Christian traditions, holds that all human law, to be legitimate and just, ought to be grounded in the natural law. I agree with that. Indeed, in a postmodern age, in which many effectively deny the existence of any objective truth about human morality and human nature, embracing this conviction may be more important than ever. The bare idea that human law must be grounded in natural law, however, leaves a huge number of practical questions up in the air. To turn this basic idea into concrete legal policy requires, first, some notion of what the natural law is, no small task in itself, and then some notion about how natural law gets worked out and applied in human law, an even bigger task, perhaps. Understandably, natural lawyers have developed sophisticated theories about how all this is to go. In this little paper, I'd first like to call attention to custom, an often forgotten but important aspect of many older theories about the relationship of natural law and human law. Then I will suggest that renewed attention to custom should encourage Christian or other religious legal scholars to investigate an area of inquiry in which they, to my knowledge, have not been much involved. Many older natural law theories acknowledge a kind of mediating entity between natural law and human law, social custom. This was true of the most famous of natural lawyers, Thomas Aquinas. Drawing on Isidore of Seville, Thomas claimed that all human law should be according to the custom of the country. Not only by legislation, he later claimed, but by actions also, especially if they be repeated so as to make a custom, law can be changed and expounded. He concludes, accordingly, custom has the force of a law, abolishes law, and is the interpreter of law. When exercising this veto power over official legislation, custom shows that the law is no longer useful. Although undoubtedly troubling to many people today, Thomas probably regarded this as not especially controversial. Justinian's Digest, as we heard about earlier, the greatest document of the Roman law tradition, not only prescribed that where there is no applicable written law, the practice established by customs and usage ought to be followed, but it also stated, statutes themselves are binding upon us for no other reason than that they have been accepted by the judgment of the populace. Is there anything to this? Yes, I believe so. The short answer why is that getting from natural law to human law requires wisdom, the topic of last year's Nootbaar conference. There is no cold rational method for determining the natural law and how exactly it ought to work out in our complex civil societies. It requires perception and prudential judgment. Wisdom, in other words. And wisdom, although a virtue possessed by individuals, is not at all individual and individualistic reality. The book of Proverbs, for example, emphasizes that people gain wisdom only in community, learning from their parents during youth, respecting the gray-haired throughout life, observing others' achievements and mistakes, humbly seeking counsel from multiple sources. From this perspective, we can say that custom is a repository of wisdom. It represents the accumulated insight of many people who have been trying to figure out how to live in this world over long periods of time. There's nothing wrong with theoretical inquiry about the relationship of natural law and human law, but if we wish to inquire with wisdom, we surely have much to learn from tried and enduring social mores. This is not to deny that custom often has many egregious failings. It is hardly infallible. But as we also know too well, legislatures are hardly infallible either. Their members do not hold office because they are the paragons of virtue. There's good reason to think that custom as a source of law has just as good, if not a better, shot at achieving justice than our election-driven, lobbyist-juiced legislators in Sacramento or Washington, D.C. Hope that didn't sound too mean. If my preceding remarks are on the right track, they raise an exciting and/or a disturbing implication. Legislatures and other state organs are not the only source of law. The influential positivist paradigm asserts that laws are commands of political superiors to inferiors. While many may find that Austinian language, John Austin, to be a bit too stark, most people in our own societies, I suspect, would find it odd to think of law as something other than what legislators and their administrative agencies proclaim it to be. But the old idea that custom may create law or even effectively veto state-created law calls that bias into question. The idea that law has multiple sources is sometimes called polycentrism. Even upon slight reflection, the idea has some intuitive appeal. Voluntary associations, such as clubs, churches, professional societies, universities, create many norms that guide our daily behavior. Private parties enter into contractual relations that create enforceable rights and duties. People and businesses often rely on mediation and arbitration to resolve disputes. These are just a few examples of how law gets created, interpreted, and enforced outside of official state processes. Many interesting legal scholars have explored and advocated the polycentric character of law. I think of Harold Berman's presentation of the thoroughly polycentric character of the early Western legal tradition. Leon Trackman's study of the pan-European medieval law merchant. Robert Ellickson's fascinating study of how ranchers in 1980s Shasta County, California, lived by their own nuanced set of unwritten norms and self-help enforcement procedures for dealing with disputes about property lines, grazing cattle, and lost animals. Or Robert Cover's famous Harvard Law Review article on the jurisgenerative character of the multitude of human communities, small and large. F.A. Hayek, Lon Fuller, Bruno Leone, David Friedman, Bruce Benson, and Randy Barnett have also made important contributions here. Of these scholars, Berman obviously had a great interest in law and religion. But as far as I'm aware, none of the others that I just mentioned do or did. Perhaps some of them were or are people of faith, but even if so, their work on polycentrism gives no indication of it. It strikes me that this is an area ripe for contribution by someone in the Guild of Christian Legal Scholars, especially given the important place of custom in the natural law tradition and the polycentric character of Christian-shaped medieval Europe. Now, I've already suggested that a biblical conception of wisdom may provide a good word for custom as a source of law, and for polycentrism by implication. Let me mention briefly two other potentially profitable areas for theological jurisprudential reflection on polycentrism. First, I suggest that a robust polycentrism promotes the elusive ideal of the rule of law. That is, that we seek a government of laws, not of men, to use the standard way of putting it. We do not want the state and its officials to be autonomous, but accountable to a standard above them. Christian theology historically has great concern for this. As Romans 13 and other biblical texts assert, civil officials are accountable to God, who has commissioned them to do justice, and not a justice simply of their own definition. The rule of law ideal is wonderful, but how to implement it is perplexing. Having written constitutions and separation of powers may ameliorate some abuses, but if we regard government bodies themselves as the source of all law, as in typical positivist schemes, we seem to fall woefully short of the genuine rule of law. In a polycentric view, however, law is still a product, is still a human product, but it is not exactly the product of human will. Law emerges spontaneously through the reciprocal and collaborative interaction of innumerable individuals and associations over the broad range of human endeavor. If we acknowledge legislation and administrative regulations to be only one source of law, or even demand that they conform to the broader customary order created through the jurisgenerative activity of myriad sources of human interaction, we keep government accountable to norms outside itself, and we approach the ideal of the rule of law in ways that no monocentric system can. Second, I suggest that acknowledging the polycentric character of law helps to keep law accessible and understandable to the people it governs. One classic aspect of the Western legal tradition is that law must be promulgated so that people know what the law is. That seems to be an obvious requirement of justice. People should not be held accountable to a standard that is an unknown mystery to them. Paul's reasoning in Romans 2, 12 through 15 raises this concern to a theological level. God himself holds people accountable only to a law that they know. But this raises a serious problem for any monocentric conception in which law is merely the product of government agencies. It is an obvious fact that most people do not and really cannot know the content of the vast corpus of legislation and administrative regulations that supposedly governs them. According to Harvey Silverglate, the average American professional unwittingly commits several federal crimes in the course of a typical day. Most of the time, no harm follows, but it does make the ordinary person vulnerable to unexpected, arbitrary, or vindictive action on the part of law enforcement. It is simply not just. What is the law by which people actually live? They live by a host of customary norms that arise from within and among the various communities in which they participate. If we consider the real world, we find that the law, the actual law that governs people's daily conduct, is in fact polycentric. By acknowledging that and enforcing the law accordingly, we protect people's ordinary expectations and thus promote justice in our communities. I mention these considerations in hope of stirring some interest, which is, of course, ludicrous, late on a Saturday afternoon, stirring interest in what, for me, is a fascinating topic. I have written a much, much longer working paper offering a theological and jurisprudential consideration of polycentrism, and I'd be happy to share and talk about it with anyone here who might happen to be interested. Thank you.
Okay, we will turn it over now. We have about 20 minutes left for questions.
All of your examples exactly the same way. But what I'm mm-hmm. to, we'll say, the Christian judge.
Yeah. So, there's a passage in the Old Testament where I think King Jehoshaphat is instructing Israel's judges about how to do their job. And he argues that they are essentially acting in God's place, and therefore they should act the way God acts. And the examples he gives are, you know, God won't take a bribe, and so you should not take a bribe, right? And so in some ways, I think God as the judge becomes the aspirational model for the human judge. I want to be just like he is just. But at the same time, I think he becomes the source of humility for the human judge as he recognizes how he falls short. And maybe that humility causes him to be a little more cautious, a little more merciful and forgiving, possibly. There's a really fascinating letter where St. Augustine is writing back and forth with a Roman judge named Macedonius, who is asking him, why are all of you Christian priests interceding on behalf of these bad criminals that are appearing before me? And Augustine's response in part is, well, you know, you also are under judgment, right? You need the mercy that you extend to these criminal defendants. And so in some ways, seeing the gap between the human judge and the divine judge can be a source of humility that makes the judge more merciful. And maybe more broadly, it can help us to moderate our expectations about what human law can accomplish, right? I think sometimes people have very utopian visions about if we just pass this law, if we just put these people in these positions, everything is going to be transformed. And I think one thing that my project suggests is that you ought to moderate those expectations, limit your understanding of what human law can accomplish, and then maybe focus on a subset of the things you would like to see happen. Yeah.
I'm tempted by that. I'm being somewhat elusive because I think it's the way I was trying to describe Catholic social thought was to move away from the idea of focusing on principles and looking at it more as a disposition or a way of being in the world. And I think something has certainly changed. I mean, if we use so on one hand, you can use. I'm not even Catholic, but I use. I mean, I've always found this tradition to be a profound way of kind of entering into the project of Christian social thought. And I think there's actually a way in which you can use Catholic social thought as a lens into the world as such. And there was this, there's been a determined sanguinity in the tradition that the world can be improved on its terms, that however distorted. And actually what's interesting is I think this sanguinity grew over time. You know, the church of the late 19th century had a determined anti-modernism about it, an illiberalism about it, and came to open up over the course of the 20th century to see these deep moral prospects within this the world as it was put before the church. It was just a very marked sanguinity and confidence, and I think we're seeing two things happening. I think there the cleavages within modernity are beginning to reveal themselves more in a more clear way. That presents a challenge for the church. And I think we're also starting to see in subtle yet discernible ways, new ways by which the Catholic Church is defining its position in relationship to the world. I think these two things are happening simultaneously. It strikes me that if you look at both Benedict and Francis, there has been, and I think there are sort of genealogical ways in which this can be explained, but something has changed. There's been a bit of a shift in tone in both of those thinkers. And I think that certainly tells us something about Catholic social thought. As to your question about modernity, quote unquote, I would say we need to put the question on the table. That probably the best we can do is to begin to at least interrogate the terms on which certainly Catholicism, and I think this has been an impulse that has defined a lot of Western Christian thought, to at least begin to interrogate the ease with which this attempt to merge church and age has defined Christian political witness. Whether we've reached a point of irredeemability, I don't know. But I think we need to interrogate the presumptions that have defined much of our engagement.
So this is a question for David. I appreciated your presentation a great deal, and it connected in my mind back to the discussion we had on criminal law, where it was pointed out that there's sort of an assumption that if the procedure is followed as it should be, then there's not much engagement with the substantive underlying outcome in terms of punishment and conditions in jail as well. And it made me think, you know, isn't that pretty much going to be the case when you have a merely positivistic view of law, right? All you can do is make sure the procedures are followed. And if your standard of justice is the human positivistic legal standard, then you've done what you can do. And I think you're suggesting that no, there should be a consideration of other ethical and moral and even, I think, to be recognized legal standards that would, in fact, check the outcome. We'll call it substantive due process, perhaps. And we used to have a category for that called equity, right? Which was where, when the law was applied to its letter, it obviously or clearly fell short because of what other avenues of ethical, moral, and even legal inquiry would show us. But that's sort of gone away. And in a positivistic legal world, it's not likely to come back. I mean, there's not room for it. What are the practical arguments to try to recover that within the legal framework that we presently have?
That's a really big question. I think I would need a lot more time to think and a lot more time to answer to do any justice to that. But it seems to me that the whole idea of equity is obviously, this is a long standing part of the Western legal tradition that is very important. And I think you're right. It is something that becomes much more difficult to think about in a positivistic view of law. I think, you know, in order for equity to work, there has to be some sort of framework for thinking about, okay, we have this sort of black letter law before us, what's the bigger background in which this law falls? What's the larger legal and moral order in which we have this rule before us? It would seem that one of the dangers of, or one of the fears about giving judges, for example, a large discretion in equity is that the judge is just going to do what he or she wants to do and get his or her desired outcome apart from what the law really is. So I think for equity to make sense, there has to be some sort of a shared conception of, all right, there is a larger moral and legal order that actually exists. And positive law is never going to fully be able to define what that order is. It's not as if we just have 100,000 more laws, we're going to get that legal order. I think that's always going to be something that transcends the letter of the law. And I guess I'd want to suggest that a polycentric notion is a way of saying, yeah, there actually are objective things to look at to help to see what that broader legal order is, that broader framework is. It's not just
a principles of equity. It wasn't just if I feel it, then it's good. And so your suggestion is looking at these other sources as kind of replacement for the notions of equity, and that may be more acceptable in a positivist.
Well, I don't know how much more they would be. Yeah, I don't know how much more they'd be acceptable necessarily to broader. But I guess I'd say that if It would take some of that discussion out of the realm of, is this just about the judge's own personal moral philosophy? And to say, here's actually evidence of what the larger legal framework is in which people are really living, in which people have certain expectations for how they ought to treat others and how other people ought to treat them. And that there's room for sort of an objective evidence there that maybe takes us beyond abstract questions of legal philosophy as defining what that equity is. But I'd be happy to hear more thoughts privately on that.
Just to note, this talk about equity called to mind Calvin's discussion of equity, which I've always found quite interesting. From the Institutes, he writes that, find the sentence here. Equity alone must be the end and rule and boundary of all laws. And then before that, it's not stated in a particularly formulaic way, but it seems to be the case that he defines equity as being more or less coterminous with what he calls the law of love. So if you sort of create an equation out of this, you reach a point where you find that the end of law is love via equity. We'd have to sort of think constructively about how that bears on this question, but I think it's an important.
And I think that is from chapter 4:16 of the Institutes when he's talking about the natural law and Mosaic law as well.
Because exactly.
I mean, he's weaving a lot of different themes in there. Yeah.
Other questions? Okay, I'd like to thank our panelists again.